You have in your packet the draft minutes of April 10, 2017 minutes. Is there a motion to approve?
Yes.
So moved. A second?
Second.
Any corrections, deletions, additions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Thank you. First item on our agenda is a three-lot subdivision, Dr. Richard Sleeper, Sleepy Hollow Road. Herb?
Yes, I've reviewed the map as well as the legal descriptions. Dr. Joe, I believe this conforms fully with our zoning ordinance and regulation. It's a simple minor subdivision.
Any comments, Joe?
No. Highway looked at it, added an issue with the road, and everything meets the minimum zoning requirements.
Any questions?
I had only a little concern about the culvert that goes under the road. Size of it?
Rick?
Going down.
What?
Oh! I went and looked at the culvert that goes through there, and all the water comes down off the hill, and all the water comes through two areas. And I wonder if it would ever be a major problem.
In Sleepy Hollow?
Yeah, for that new one.
Right.
None that you could figure out?
No.
Okay. That was my observation when I went out and looked.
Anybody else? Are you all done?
Yes, sir.
Just one question. Is it a dedicated right-of-way?
It is, yes.
It is.
Anything else? Anybody? A motion of some sort?
To approve the subdivision?
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Thank you. Next item, Mr. Michael Owens, corner of Snowden, Oxford Roads, four-lot minor subdivision. Herb?
Same thing, four-lot minor subdivision. I've reviewed the map as well as the legal descriptions. I believe it conforms fully with our ordinance.
Joe?
Yeah, same thing. In conformance with our ordinance.
Any questions on this one? Yes, Julius?
The lots is marked, there's a bunch of flagging up there and stakes in the ground. Is that what's marked up there now?
I'm not sure if the corners are marked. I know there, you know, surveyor obviously put a lot of marks up there for when he did the topographic and boundary survey to describe the properties.
Okay. That's it.
Anybody else? A motion regarding this matter?
So moved.
Okay.
To approve the four-lot minor subdivision?
Sorry, I made the motion first.
Okay.
And the second was? Any further comments or discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Thank you. The Meadows at Middle Settlement Road, 4310 Middle Settlement Road, North Hartford, amendment to final. Jim?
Yes.
Delano? How you doing tonight?
Good evening.
You want to take us through this, please?
Absolutely. I have a board, if that would help.
Sure.
It shows the overall. Standing right up here is okay? Story's target for right one. This is an amendment to a site plan that was approved by the board back in 2015. Since that approval, building code has changed, which requires that the buildings that are constructed within the 100-year floodplain be set at an elevation that's minimum 2 feet above that established flood elevation. Prior to that, it was 1 foot, and that was what was designed. So as, in order to, there were two buildings, buildings E and F, that were in partially within the floodplain. As part of the previous approval, we went through the flood mitigation, and compensatory mitigation, went through the Army Corps, got received, everybody's reviewed and approved it. And so what we had to do was raise essentially buildings E and F 1 foot in elevation roughly. And to do that, what we did is we just raised the building elevation. We had to shift building E back about 3 feet to accommodate an ADA accessible sidewalk and a couple of stairs. Building F, we just raised the elevation and changed the grades immediately around the front and shifted the parking lot. We added a little bit of impervious area as part of that, but what we did to offset that was we made a porous parking lot along each, where the cars park along the parking lot that compensates services, I should say, buildings E and F. As part of this, at the same time, Beacon Communities, who is still the same entity that was here before, was Omni Development. Omni Development sold off their housing side of it to Beacon Communities. And Duncan Barrett, who was here before us with Omni, also went with them. He was basically the principal. So he's still involved. But as part of the construction sequencing, they'd like to keep buildings 22 and 23, which is actually just one long building, on lot 3 until they move into the next phase of development. And the sole reason for that is to be able to accommodate the shuffling of people that live there, the residents that live there. So what we did is we looked at the overall impervious surfaces of the project, what increase does this have, and that also contributed to us making the porous pavement over here so that we're still reducing the overall impervious by over 25%. We're actually close to 30%, which means we don't have to do anything special for the stormwater design. By keeping buildings 22 and 23 in place, that actually increased the amount of parking that we actually needed to provide. And I'm going to say keep, because we never eliminated parking to serve that. But what necessitated is we still have enough parking on site to serve the project as design, and originally we had identified this parking area right in the middle that serves building C and D as being future parking. It's going to be landscaped until such time that the need arises for the residents. For the board members over here, or those that may not have been here, the presentation that was given was that the residents, there's a huge amount of parking that's not used presently, and this project is not increasing any. It's just going to be taking in, moving people into new modern update facilities. So the justification was that if they build it, if we need to, we'll build it in the future. That would be porous pavement when it does get constructed, so stormwater design criteria is still applied, still the same. So really what ends up happening is you granted a waiver allowing us to postpone building the 20 parking spaces serving building C and D until the need arises, which meant that it's a greater percentage waived. Still under 10%. So we're looking for a 7.6% waiver of having to construct a build for parking at this time. Other than that, building layouts, parking, stormwater management, everything is exactly the same as it was previously, with the exception of the increase in the waiver required.
Joe?
Question, Jim. How long can we expect the older buildings there to stay?
Until they come in and look to build this. Right now, we're looking at this probably a 3 or 4 year construction process, because all the residents are there and they have to move them around. There's enough vacancies right now with keeping this building 22 and 23 in here, that they'll move people in and not to keep moving them multiple times as we build it. So it's probably 4 years, and at that point, they'll likely become coming in to get site plan approval for this. So once lot one gets built out, and essentially what it was to be taking down all those existing buildings, I'm just putting two more buildings over in here. That's when all the buildings on lot 3 will be taken down. As part of this original site plan approval, we showed the hike, biking trail, not, shouldn't say biking trail, a walking trail out on that island. We also had agreed that, you know, in the future we'd excavate that out to provide some more compensatory flood mitigation, even though we've already provided it for everything. I know that it's historically a problem in this area, so 5 years, when this project went, could be longer.
So before you were going to take the buildings out, there were just going to be more moves for people?
Yes.
Okay.
That's exactly what it was.
Okay.
You know, they were looking at taking, so when they, their intent is to start building building D, which means they have to tear down a bunch of, a number of buildings in this location, which means they have to shift them to all the vacancies throughout currently. And then once they finish that, they'll take the residents that are in this built, you know, in this area, move them over into that building. And then when the time comes, they're going to have to take down more buildings, and they're going to be moving people back and forth. That's the most complicated part of this entire construction project. Usually it's utility sequencing, it's people sequencing is going to be the biggest challenge for Beacon Communities and Presbyterian Homes.
Anything, Chris? Mm-hmm. Do you have anything else, Joe?
Herb? Nope.
Planning board members? Julius? You're studying all this, so I'm just curious.
My only question is with the impervious surface and how you treat that relative to your slip. How did you figure that in? Did you figure that in as your total area of disturbance, or did you figure that, did you pull it out when you gave a number of greater than 25% disturbance?
What we did is we calculated the existing impervious on site, mm-hmm. and compared that to the final impervious on site. Mm-hmm. And well, including the pervious asphalt areas
is included as
permeable. And that, with those surfaces and all the green space, we have in excess of 25% reduction.
But you still, when you looked at any, you're ultimately looking at your footprints. How did you address your actual runoff? Did you change, you appropriately changed your runoff coefficient?
Yes,
or,
okay. That is correct, yes. We completed a HydroCAD model and did the hydraulic analyses to design the storm sewer systems.
Okay. Anything else? Anybody else? Would there be a motion to approve the plans as amended?
So moved.
A second?
Yes.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Thank you. Thanks.
One thing that I could ask, with Beacon Communities coming into play, could that motion include something in regards to the waiver of the parking requirements? They've been kind of beating me up trying to find something in there. The attorneys for Beacon Communities and the financing companies.
The planning board has a right to grant a waiver.
Then we do that when we approve.
I thought we did the first time.
We did, but yeah. We've increased the amount of the waiver that was required before. It's like 5%.
But it's reflected on the plans, right?
Right, but actually yeah. There isn't a standard for this type of housing in our code, so it's a judgmental decision by the planning board to determine the sufficiency of the parking.
Is someone inclined to make a motion regarding the waiver?
Well, can I ask a question?
Sure.
I don't mean to sound ignorant about the parking spots, but what are we increasing them to what they are today? So what are you asking for in actual numbers? I just hear percentages.
Okay. The required parking was 157 spaces.
One
per unit. Okay. We provide 155 spaces, but that's including the 20 that's future here. So we're actually 165 here, 165. So we're providing 145 out of the 157 required when we take out the 20 parking spaces. So that's the waiver. And we expect that there's not 145 cars being parked out there as it is now on site, there's much less parking than that.
Do you know the average number of vehicles per unit currently? And is it because that there's no vacancy?
It's less than one. It's much less than one.
Okay, because you said you mentioned he had vacancy, so I didn't know that. I mean, obviously that contributes to...
It's much, much, much less than one.
Do you have anything further on that, Joe? Do you have a problem with that, Joe?
Should they have one per unit?
As I said, the parking schedule in our ordinance does not stipulate for this type of housing.
Oh, okay.
We have long-term care housing, we have multifamily housing. If you wanted to interpolate between the two, it probably would be one space per unit.
And keep in mind that their residents are going to be very vocal if they don't have enough parking, and they're going to build this parking. So it's kind of a temporary request. We're not asking for a permanent, not have to build it, but build it if the need actually arises based upon the tenant's needs.
So is there something in the agreement when people move in that they may not secure a parking spot?
No.
So they may move in and not realize there might not be parking for them? Potentially. If the average is one spot per unit, we've got these units, and like you said, some are less, some are higher.
My expectation is that while they're doing it, if they're approaching that where they're saturated, they'll be building this long before that because they want tenants in. It's not something that, it's not like a shopping plaza or a mall, it's like they can't deal with it. If you can't move, if you don't have a parking space, you don't move in. I wouldn't move in.
What's the demographic of the units?
Oh, this is all independent living seniors. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are well in their 70s and up. Maybe some younger, but not many of them are driving. It's affiliated with Presbyterian Homes, which is the continued care.
No, on my site visits, there are ample parking. I mean,
I have a question. It's not that cold, but it's
very... I wouldn't think it would be good.
Well, he's asked to grant a waiver as it relates to parking spaces. Joe said that this type of facility is not specifically defined, so our ordinance doesn't really regulate it at this point, but he's probably having
based
trouble.
Based on one-on-one, correct.
Yeah.
And Presbyterian Homes said that, we actually calculated the number of parking spaces, and even what we're providing is well in excess of what they've ever used during their entire management thing. I'm hoping that they're going to be more mobile seniors moving in here that do all have cars and will continue to be able to...
So if there's nothing in the code that stipulates the number of parking spaces that they need, why do they need a waiver?
Well, there's no guideline, but in the original approval...
Because of the approval of the original plan?
One space per unit was a good standard to follow.
Right.
As your right of the planning board to interpolate when it's not specifically listed. So now they're asking for slightly less.
So we're granting a waiver over what we approved originally.
Exactly.
Even as part of the original, these were always going to be future. So at that original site plan, we weren't building this initially. And when it transfers from Omni to Beacon, Beacon's attorneys are all looking at it, asking all this, like, well, what's our right? What do we have for site plan approval? What are we obligated to build? What are we obligated to do right now? And that's exactly where they're at. They just want to make sure they have something, even if it's just an integration into the resolution that you have, is that 20 future parking can be built at the time. I don't know how to word it. I didn't think of how to structure that, but.
Well, you can approve it as shown, as our ordinance does not require a specific number of parking spaces, and based upon the future showing 20 future spaces without specifying a specific number.
I think you have a great project. I just know that people, you got a couple that move into space, both of them can be gardened, not just one, or none of them can be gardened. And to have someone move in thinking they both have parking spaces because they showed up in an afternoon where there's open spaces, and not be aware of it, it's kind of, you know. So I have an issue with that, but I love the project.
I have that same concern, because I've lived in condominium, and the two cars is always a problem, and I'm over 70.
Again, it's stipulated that it'll be built in the future when the need arises for the residents. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. We're not asking you to waive it and not show anything at all. We're just asking you to allow us to defer parking 20 spaces to a time when the residents' needs.
But Jim, it might be more easier to digest if you could say that the parking lot will be built at such a time when so many units are up or something like that.
They're not taking on any new residents. They have a certain amount of vacancies, but they also have a waiting list. This is affordable housing in the local community. This is, you know, so they're trying to keep their construction costs down to maintain that affordability. FHA is involved. That's really what the delay has been. It's been the financing, the structure, the grants, how everything's went through. And so this is just one way that they're trying to minimize overall construction costs, as well as not to overbuild something. I mean, that their whole idea is to reduce the amount of impervious surfaces on the site, and also to minimize their construction costs.
But didn't we approve that with the plans? So the lawn, potential
first
for 20,
time, yes, you did.
Lawn, potential for 20 future parking spaces should demand this uptake. So if we approved everything as is, then we're granting
I'm confused on the waiver too, because it's already been done.
Yeah, it's done.
They're leaving up more units
this time.
Scheduled to demolish.
As part of this.
Changes everything.
Correct. Goes from like a 5% waiver to a 7% waiver, just because there's eight more units in buildings 22 and 23, so we had to provide an additional 8 parking. But nothing's been changed. We didn't add any parking. We didn't take any away. All we did was leave up this one building temporarily until the whole occupation is done, and then it's built. These buildings will all come down once they rebuild, because these buildings that can be used to shuffle these people, because when they move into the next phase, these units can be all used up during the people sequencing.
But that's in your application.
Our application is not to build lot one at this point. Overall, the original application was for phase one build out and phase two build out. Seeker determination originally was for all of that. The SWIFT was for the entire thing. The water and sewer infrastructure designs, it was for full build out of the project. Site plan approval was for just lots two and the waiver. And that was phase one. That's why if you look at the whole site plan package, it was full build out of everything. We're just asking for an amendment for phase one at this point.
I'm just going to offer this to the board and everybody else. The permit application, what we approved, said required number of spaces are now 7.6% less than the required number of spaces. So they identified the total number of spaces as being reduced, and the need for that, I really don't. I mean, all somebody would like to make them. It doesn't matter to me one way or the other, because I see it's already in the application. We approved the site plan as it is. So it says it's already in the application.
7.6.
Yeah, I don't see the.
Well, that was my point at the beginning of all. It's reflected in what we approved.
Could we just say and the requested parking waiver? Just add that to the resolution and the requested.
Confirm the parking waiver.
I mean, if it's in here, then there shouldn't. You seem to. If it's in here and you think that's what it is, I'm not trying to be difficult. I'm being sincere.
Oh, I can appreciate it. This is something that I kept telling them. It's like, hey, the site plan is approved with the waiver. Everything's approved with it. And the only reason I'm raising it is again because...
If for some reason it was approved within it, now all of a sudden you want a reaffirmation of it, I don't understand why you need a reaffirmation.
If that's a problem, don't worry about it, just leave it the way it is. Your attorneys will deal with it. I'm not asking for anything different than we already have.
It'll be reflected in the minutes. We had a lot, lengthy discussion with parking waiver, and you're okay with the 7.6%.
Yeah.
I mean, you could give that to the attorneys.
I'm perfectly fine with that. That'll satisfy me.
Then we're done.
Good, we're done. Thank you.
So we're leaving it at 7.6?
We're leaving it at exactly what's in the application.
Yeah.
Which we approved.
Okay.
Did you take the vote?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Seeker determination, if you're doing with that special or?
No. That's done.
Okay, beautiful. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thanks. Next, we'll have for Lunchville Apartments, 167 Clinton Road, Al. Kurt, why don't you refresh the board? This one's a little bit different than how we normally operate. So
yeah, you're doing, this is a PD overlay request, which is before the town board. And what happens is they refer it to you to do the site plan approval and give a recommendation as to whether or not to grant a PD overlay. So that's the purpose that you're here for, and he's doing the actual site plan.
Is the recommendation of the town board also for approval of the site plan, or are
yes.
we approved? We're not approving the
well,
site
you're plan. Recommending that the site plan be approved based upon your review.
Yeah. Just want everybody clear on that. Joe or Chris, you want to start this thing off?
Well, I'll start off with the last time Al was in front of the board. We actually have gone through a kind of a separate design since then because Army Corps had a big issue with the amount of wetlands, made them do a wetland delineation. We had all the wetlands flagged. We've redesigned the area. I'm not sure if you have a map or anything that you're showing, Al, or if it's just what's in front of people.
There is a, I think it's...
So what you see is there are ponds, there are bridges, there are wetlands now. Other than that, I mean, not a lot really on the site change other than kind of shifting things around to accommodate those wetlands. We had a number of seeker responses from DOT, Army Corps, let me get my in the back of that, my last letter, Fire Department, all those have all been addressed, and parking spots and parking with Joe has been addressed. So at this point, we're okay. I mean, he's met our requirements as far as the comments we had at the last meeting, which was February, January. I can't remember the last time we were meeting before then. So
when they were in front of us?
That may have been even 2016.
No, I think it was okay. 2016.
So all the secret comments have come out to come back about items of significance.
We ended up sending that back out after that whole change because it changed significantly enough. We did another coordinator review. All those have come back. We've addressed the comments that they had the second time, and we've got responses back that they're good with the revised contracts.
Gotcha.
Yep.
Joe, are you hiding
Joe's
someplace?
Here. Yeah.
Oh. Do you have any comments on this?
No.
Or, nope. Board members?
I have a couple questions.
Fire away.
So when we last saw, talked about this, please correct me if I'm wrong. I'm going to remember. I thought that when the project was presented, that there were some economic, I'm trying to think of the right wording here, income levels that were talked about. And I actually kind of remember it coming up and we had quite a discussion about it. And I also remember at the town board level that Councilman Michoni also brought up several questions about it. So I guess my questions are, have the buildings changed and the amount of units and the types of units and who they're going to be marketed to? And the groups that are going to be marketed to, are there, because I see moderate income for some of the apartments. So I'm just trying to understand how the project has changed versus if it has at all.
The project has changed slightly. The wetlands resulted in these two buildings going away altogether. They were impacted by it. The items you're bringing up are not really engineering items. Steve, would you care to address those?
There's no changes as far as the income level target, except, you know, like I said, we just lost those, the condo building.
Yeah, there are two condo buildings that went away.
Okay.
So when I look at, because the only thing I had for the new plans was, I believe, what's right down here in this corner, mm-hmm. and I didn't get a chance to call Joe. So is the mix, the percentages changed? And trust me, I'm not for or against anything. I'm just asking because I was curious about it.
Well, the mix has changed ever so slightly. That the number of condo units has gone down.
That's what I thought. The number of apartments have gone up.
Yep.
So, because I think last time you visited with us, we talked about how there'd be three sections. You'd have a luxury condominium sort of in the back, and then some other condominiums and then apartments, and I could be wrong, I just remember. And so that it was going to be, this was going to be built first and second and third. Is that still sort of the plan going forward?
Yes, the plan is to continue with the buildings on the left side of the sheet, buildings one and two, then continue building three.
So you're going to build the apartments first?
No, the apartments were...
Because that's buildings one and two.
One and two are apartments.
The ones on the left are apartments, but they're not necessarily the ones that I think that you're referring to for the other moderate income ones.
Okay, but luxury, yeah, one and two luxury.
Yes, one and two are luxury apartments. Buildings four and five
yeah.
are the moderate. Category that would be moderate.
Yeah.
So when you come in off the road, you'll be going by the... Sorry about that. That's part garage, but there's apartments here, right? I'm just trying to.
Well, there's some right here.
Yeah.
No.
So on the, I'm almost done. So on the 36 apartments, you've got 99 apartments luxury. You've got, is it 6 or 8 and 21, like 29 luxury condominiums. And then you have 36 apartments moderate income.
Yes.
Yes. And so, okay, so all 99 of the apartments are luxury, 36 of the apartments are moderate income, and they're separate apartments, they're separate buildings. So you've separated them.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, that table that you're referring to refers to buildings four and five, which is the one in the center and the one in the lower center. Mm-hmm. It's a little hard to read that scale, but building four is the one right in the middle. Building five is, the yards are good. There's five.
Yeah.
There's four.
Four.
So all of this is being built at the same time?
No.
No. And I know you just kind of answered
The first phase that we talked about was phase one, which is buildings one and two.
Okay, so it's section one, section two,
yeah.
section three. Okay.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, so you're going to build the 99, 60, I can't remember,
yeah,
I'm sorry. 66 luxury, it's not funny at all. apartments first.
Right, in section, yes. You
okay.
can see on the again, going back to the table in the lower
yep.
right-hand corner.
Yep.
Section one is buildings one and two on the left.
Mm-hmm.
Phase two becomes buildings three and four. The ones fronting right on Clinton Road and the one behind it, building for the apartment building.
So you're going to build the ones on the upper level first?
Upper level and on the west side or left side, yes.
Yeah.
I only have one other question, not related to that, but related to traffic studies. And I know, just a quick question. So the state has, Chris, the state did respond about traffic in and out of there.
Regarding Clinton Road?
Yeah.
Yeah, yes.
And they're okay with it?
Yes.
Yeah, there was a traffic study that was done and submitted to.
I remember. I just wanted to make sure
it's safe.
Okay, those
were
my only questions.
Yeah, one of them was right there.
They responded on April 20th. Was the email land?
Okay.
That's.
Okay, could I ask, are you going to widen the road? There's a road up. Because I just went out and said this today. No, your entry.
Yes.
You're going to widen that from what it is right now?
No, it's shown as a 24-foot road. All the main roads are all 24-footers.
Okay.
Which is pretty much to the town standard.
Standard, yeah.
In fact, you think your town standard is only a 20-foot road?
Anything else, Peggy?
Well, I just found that having been out there an hour ago, when there was traffic, they're zipping by there. I don't know whether they're adhering to the speed limit or not, but I pulled off to look at the road and I got blasted with about four horns.
Was that you?
Yeah, that's a C-strike right here.
So, you know, I think we have to look at that very seriously and very carefully.
Well, DOT's already signed off on this.
Chris, just said that.
So.
So is it the intent that we ask the town, and maybe it's too early to ask this, that the roads would be dedicated to the town, or they're going to just remain internal roads? Internal roads?
Private? All yours?
Yeah.
You
could have great trouble.
I'm just saying, I mean, it goes to the question, you know, you got 129 units, right? So you've got a potential 200 people going to work in the morning. And so you're pulling out, you want to take a left, and you've got 12, you can't get a car past it to take a right, or vice versa. I don't know, but I won't.
I wouldn't live here if I had to make a left against that traffic in the morning.
No.
I mean, they'll have to figure it out themselves. Why are you there?
It is definitely a concern, a left turn. Did you guys think about it all?
Yeah, we handed out the DOT.
DOT gave you a clear.
The department's comments concerning the luxury apartments have been addressed. The project will progress with a highway permit. Yep. Could you let the planning board know? It would be appreciated. That was.
Okay.
Any other questions?
All the roads will be built to town standards. So for the future, that.
It isn't what you're doing, it's the concern of having, like she says, everybody going to work pretty much the same time. A left turn off of there is definitely going to be a problem.
Well, that's one of the reasons I think that Rick was looking for two roads out of the site.
Yep.
To maybe reduce the traffic on any one in particular.
But I think that had to deal with fire issues, though, right?
That too.
Yeah. I actually have one follow-up question. How many parking spaces are you having? That's a lot of parking spaces.
262.
262. Okay,
two
I like
per
that.
Unit.
All right.
That's better.
No waiver.
The requirements for, we have 129 apartments.
Yeah.
Two per one, two per each. So we're talking about the need for us 258. We're providing 262. So if there's any visitor parking, it's covered someplace.
Yeah.
We got an maintenance crew.
Any other questions? So, Herb, we're making, if someone chooses to move it, a recommendation to the town board to accept the site plan review, the site plan as presented, as well as to close SECR, because they're the lead
correct
agency under SECR, and there were no findings of significance from our coordinated review two times out.
And you're recommending the approval of the plan development overlay.
And that. So someone care to make that motion or some other motion?
That one complete motion with three different parts? Or
yes. It sounds good.
Yeah.
Thanks, Brian.
I'll second it.
So Primer made it.
Any other comments or concerns?
Get that out there. I don't know if I can repeat it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anybody opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
I got that word for you.
And can we please not have another one of these? They're too confused on this whole thing. I don't. Anyways.
Are you bad one?
Yeah. Next item on our agenda, Oneida County Emergency Communications Project, 623 Higbee Road. Counselor Amanda Cortez.
This is Assistant County Attorney Amanda Cortez.
Hello. Robert Duclos with CNS Engineers. He's going to be the one to answer all the technical questions.
Does he have a car? Does he have a car?
I do.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Amanda, SECR was already completed on this?
It was.
I just wanted to have been, the county already completed SECR.
Who's lead agency?
The county.
County.
So what's this still in front of us?
Site plan.
I'm sorry, you want to take us through this, please? Do we need to be taken through this?
I do.
We're just interested.
Well, I'm very confused as to why this is in front of us myself, so I'm having a hard time with this. We're not, SECR's already gone out and closed.
Correct.
Correct.
So what are we doing again?
We are at the stage we have applied for a building permit, and that, as I understand it, was put in front of this board as part of, to do site plan review, as part of the process to get the building.
Joe?
A public entity, like Communication Tower, has to come before the town planning board for a site plan review.
Okay, so let's go through your site plan and see what we're talking about.
Okay, well, I'll be happy to provide you with a brief overview of what the county is doing overall, and then I'll just focus on what's proposed on the road. I'm Bob Duclos from CNS Engineers in Syracuse, where the county's consulting engineer, and a little over a year ago, the county started or embarked on an improvement to their 911 communication system, and they received from some funds from the state of New York, and basically their existing system is quite antiquated, and as many counties are doing in central New York, they're improving their existing system. Project started about a year ago, and there's nine communication sites that the county is doing in different parts of the county. This is obviously one of the nine that's being proposed, and they have the county is building four new communications towers in different parts of Oneida County. There's one here in the town of New Hartford. There's one in the town of Bridgewater, one in the city of Rome, and then one in the town of Kirkland, and then there's another one in the city of Utica on Burstone Road. And then there's some existing towers in the county that they own that are also receiving new communications equipment as well. What the project is going to do overall is it's solely for public safety. It's for police, fire, ambulance, and emergency responders. It's not for cell phone communications or communications carriers on the commercial side. So basically, one of the nine sites that the county is doing is located on Higbee Road, and there's a site plan there in front of you. One thing that I would emphasize is that the location of all these sites is very important in relation to one another, so they're all connected, and ultimately all of the information and data that is collected from these sites, from calls from emergency responders, is ultimately sent back to the 911 center out in Oriskany. And then the second point I would make is that it's very important that the communication sites be located next to population centers, because emergency responders obviously go in buildings, so it's very important from a coverage standpoint that these sites can get coverage of where the people and where the emergency responders go. So that's just generally a broad overview of what the county is doing. From a schedule standpoint, they've actually started construction on the project. The tower over on Burstone Road is under construction right now. The county's ultimate objective is to get the entire project built and operational by September of this year. That's when the testing will begin. But ultimately, as I said earlier, this is for all the emergency response agencies in Oneida County, City of Utica, City of Rome, and throughout the county. As far as the Higbee Road site that's proposed, this is on a small parcel of land, as you'll see on the site plan that you have. But essentially what would be constructed is a 195-foot tall freestanding steel lattice tower. There'd be no guy wires associated with the tower that's proposed. At the base of the tower, it would be a 50 by 50 chain link fenced area. Within the fenced area, there would be a 12 by 20 pre-engineered communication shelter, like you've probably seen in similar facilities that you may even have in the town. And inside that shelter would be the county's radio communications equipment that would make the facility function. The only other thing that would be on the ground at the base of the tower is an emergency generator. And the purpose of that, that would only come on in the event of a power outage in the area or at the site. So that's really it. In a nutshell, there's no paving that would be proposed as part of the construction. There would be no employees that would work there. There would be no normal traffic that would go in and out of the facility. All the operations at the site can be monitored at the 911 center. So if there was an alarm, if somebody broke in to the fenced area or into the building, the county would have knowledge of that from the 911 center, and they could send somebody to to the site to see what's going on. So normally somebody would come out to the site maybe once a month to just check on things, but ultimately there would not be any traffic or employees working at the facility. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have about what's proposed. One more thing, I would be remiss. The tower would not be have a light on it. It's below the height required by the FAA for lighting, so it would not be a lit tower. So,
do you happen to have a schematic of what it would look like from if I was standing there and looked at the landscape as to the height? Because I looked through here, not that you had to have that, I'm just asking right. If you have one that we could look at.
Well, as far as the secret, did you do a visual EAF for any type of view sheds for that? I mean, when we looked at the cell tower in the same neighborhood, it was quite the issue. And this is a lot taller than that was.
We had balloons. We had balloons.
Yes, it's a lot taller. Did you do it?
Yeah,
the visual
had like 6 months
EAF,
on that one.
Yeah, just waiting. We have not done what's called you may be familiar with the balloon test, which we've done at certain times for various projects, but we only do those, at a specific request if it's required. So we have not flown a balloon.
But do you have any kind of schematic so that you could look at it?
So we don't have that for you this evening, of course. Certainly we could show you examples of what these look like. I'm sure you've seen them before, but we don't have a visual rendering for you this evening to show you.
Are we going to have a public hearing about this?
I don't see where it identifies surrounding property ownership.
Yeah, we would be happy to provide you with neighboring property owners if you need that. I think that we're here for informational purposes. I think we're getting back to your original question about why we're here. I think normally county public safety projects do not go before planning and zoning boards, but I think in the interest of making sure that any questions that you might have are answered or addressed, Amanda and I wanted to come here to let you know what the county's plans were. So. We did not structure our site plan or an application as you would maybe normally have for somebody coming in for a variance
Well, then I'm confused on a lot. Joe, what's the law on this again? I mean, if this is if they're here for a formal site plan review, they either get approval or not at approval. We have that authority to say no?
Our Schedule A is very clear and very limited.
And we have the authority to say exactly what it is we're looking for before we make that determination. And who signed off on behalf of the town as far as CEQA was concerned when the county did the coordinated review?
Yeah, so I think last summer there was lead agency letters that were distributed. It was not sent to the planning board. I think it went to the town supervisor. And that was the coordinating part of it. So obviously your board may not have been tuned into that or have seen that, but that's the mechanism. As you probably know, because this is a countywide project, SEACR needed to be taken care of as a collective action rather than segmenting it up into, you know, 9 different actions in various communities. So the county was the lead agency under SEACR.
Well, I don't have a problem with any of that. I'm curious as to how the town responded regarding...
Yeah, I think it probably went under the radar screen. Is probably my thought, because...
Did it go in your house? You didn't get it. A letter went to the town supervisor. It was in July of 2016. The exact date I don't have off the top of my head, but to my knowledge, there was no response.
Which, of course, is a yes under SEACR.
Yeah.
Well, I guess you all have to decide what you want.
One other question. Why doesn't the county sell or lease... sell company positions on a tower this high? I mean, we right next to it, according to this broad map, we've just approved a 90-foot cell tower, and
100 something.
This is going to be 120 maybe. All right, but this is 195 higher elevation
and broader
and bigger.
Couldn't the two have been...
Right, so I could probably help with that. So first of all, whenever that we do these new towers for counties, they're always built with additional capacity in them to support other antennas. So somewhere down the road, if there was a need or a request to locate additional antennas on the tower, it would be able to structurally support it. But what I wanted to emphasize in the beginning is we're here solely for the purposes of requesting approval for a public safety tower, not a commercial tower that's going to generate revenue for anybody. There's no cell carriers that have expressed interest in this particular tower, so there's nothing like that involved with this. The other thing I would say, I am familiar with the fact that you have another application from Verizon Wireless, right? To build a shorter tower down lower in the heart of, I think it's in the village, right?
In the village.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we actually did check into that. And they are building that site for capacity reasons. So they actually, we heard about the fact that they were building a tower in New Hartford, and we actually gave them the location of this tower and asked them if there was any potential to whether they had an interest in co-locating on this tower. And they actually need to be down closer to the population center because it's what they call a capacity site. So their Verizon is building a tower for very different reasons. It's not coverage, it's capacity. So I don't know if that's helpful, but in this case, there wouldn't be any ability to co-locate and really serve both parties'
right.
needs.
The yeah. tower that we're referring to was not for capacity for defense
yeah.
spots, but it was just a little bit south on Higbee Road.
That was on Higbee Road.
Yeah.
It was a capacity. We have to do all sorts
well,
of
things. Well, I find it confusing that when a public utility for the public's good wants to build a tower, we have a very stringent and a long process, it seems, where if the county wants to do the same thing, basically, it's carte blanche.
Well, they did send, they said they sent a letter to the town supervisor, so they were following SEACR. I mean, if he didn't respond, he must have felt there was no problem or he had no questions. He understood the whole project and it was clear to him and he
Or he never received it.
Or he didn't receive
it. Or he ever received it, which is also potential. The last time when we were approached for the cell tower that's up on Higbee Road, there was a great deal of public concern. Mm-hmm. And it certainly doesn't look terribly good to have one just another edifice stuck there without any community knowledge or input. And I'm concerned about that because there was a lot of concern.
So, you know, one of the other things...
And I think from a public support, you have to address this, and you're not. You haven't done it at this point. And a letter to the supervisor, which was never acknowledged, it could have gotten lost in the mail.
And it's just one person's opinion. If it...
Yeah.
Even if it was received, it's only one person's opinion, apparently, at this stage.
And that would be a... And I'm not trying to make your life difficult, but we have to live in the community.
Yeah, I understand.
How long, can I ask a question? So how long have you been working on this project? How long, when did it conceptually start, and the idea that it would need to be in Hartford up in that area, that it was kind of isolated?
Well, the project started about a year ago.
Okay, so you hadn't looked at anything up until a year ago, no sites or anything?
I would say, yeah, that's correct, yeah.
And then, by probably early summer is when we started to identify the particular areas that we would need to locate towers in. You know, again, we're putting some new equipment on existing towers, but that's when we began to determine what areas we needed to place additional towers in to make this system work. So, you know, again, kind of going back to the system, this will create a system that will cover the entire county, and it will allow all, in essence, first responders, police, fire, ambulance, to communicate not only with each other on the system, but also across agencies. So, you know, for example, New Hartford Police will be able to communicate with fire departments, with other police agencies, with the sheriff's department, and with the 911 center, all on the same system, which is something that doesn't currently exist. And so probably early summer is when we started to identify where we, and this is in consultation with the radio consultant that we're using, where they started to identify where we would need to place towers in order to provide this coverage. Then once New Hartford, and you know, again, it's sort of an area that's identified that will work, was identified, we began to look for a particular piece of property, and we started to communicate with the owner of this property originally about a property across the street that he owns, and then it was in the fall, I believe, that, you know, negotiations for with him with the lease agreement.
I don't know.
The map doesn't tell me where it is.
It's owned by Dr. Rao.
Okay. Dr. Rao.
Okay,
yeah.
That's what I thought, probably.
It looked like it, but...
Just a couple questions. First, what are we here to approve? I guess that's because it's a building permit? It's in the code?
No, Schedule A. Permitted uses section of our code requires a public entity to get site plan approval.
So what they're looking at recommendations.
Well, do they have to fill out the same application for site plan review with all the requirements, such as, you know, buying properties, et cetera?
Sure. See, I've done this in a bunch of counties, and this is not really my place to say this. I'm not an attorney, but I've done this for years for many counties across the state. And public safety communications projects done by counties are exempt from special use permits, site plan approvals, planning boards, zoning boards, pretty much universally determined across the state. We're really not, again, I'm not trying to speak out of line here, but I frankly don't think that we're here to get formal site plan approval. Aren't they, Joe?
Based on Schedule A, I can't say it anymore.
Then yeah. I think we need an application for a formal review. That's what the law calls for. So welcome to New Hartford.
Yeah, understood. I was just throwing that out there. I think this all got started by filing for a building permit, and I think your codes enforcement officer kicked it to the planning board.
So. I'm concerned that this area somehow or other is going to turn into Tower Central for our town, and I'm very much opposed to that. You'll be in. Granted, it's a noble cause. I have no issue with this. Appreciate all the agencies you're talking about. And then Verizon's tower gets gobbled up and somebody's going to come in and say they want another tower up by T tilted and it'd be road. So I'm concerned about this location, very concerned about it. And if the law says that this is, that's why I asked this question at the very beginning of this thing. If the law says a site plan review.
It's in our statute. I don't disagree, though, and in talking to the municipal lawyers and some of the other municipalities, they've exempted it out because of emergency services. I do recall last year, Chief and Sarah having discussed this with us and talked about the need for this system, because what it's going to do, it's going to connect everybody up. And he felt that this is a vital service to the town of New Hartford, because it would enable him immediately to be able to get on 911, whatever, and access crucial information regarding potential individuals or potential threats.
But I don't think the question that we talked about is the need, because I think if there's a need, there's a need, and I can't define the need. Only people who are involved with emergency services and working with engineers can tell us and explain to us the need. But I think the question comes down to, we started a half hour ago and we're still at it. Are they required to come to us? And you're saying, yes, they are. That it's in our schedule.
It's in our
schedule. But I'm looking for your opinion. Your opinion is that they come before us because it's in our statute.
Because we're a home rule state.
Right. So I guess if it says that, and there's nothing that says another legal clause somewhere that says that they're exempt, that's above us, then I guess they have to come.
Well, I have not researched emergency communications facilities. I think Amanda has, and I think that's where the exemption comes in.
And I didn't say what I said earlier to get anybody upset, so please don't interpret it that way. I only said what I said is because I've done this in a bunch of other counties, and I have done this in communities where there were residents who were not in favor of the location of the tower, exactly as one of you had mentioned earlier. And I was standing before the planning board and zoning board for 6 months, going through meetings and public hearings and things of that nature. And ultimately, it was a necessity for the 911 and emergency response community to have a tower in that location. It ultimately went to court, and ultimately it was determined officially that a public safety project implemented by county public services is exempt from local planning, special use permits, and
things. Well, if that's the case, then you should research this for us, because we're just spinning our wheels here.
I wouldn't expect you to do anything.
A commercial carrier would come and tell us what other sites within an area also could be effective, not just this particular site next to yet another tower, but perhaps on Water Authority property up the road, or all the sites we looked at with Verizon before we ended up with the tower that we had. But if we don't have jurisdiction over this thing, I don't want it in front of this board. Either we do or we don't. So that's
the question. I'll be happy to review it and render a written opinion.
You're very welcome. There are some court of appeals decisions that lay out the test for
it. We don't care about the court of appeals.
I will send you the citations if you want.
So I'd
like to make a motion that we postpone this until a future date.
Because I'm very confused. We have a lawyer here that says we don't even need to come before us, and nobody really knows. It's very confusing.
We just want to be a good neighbor. Obviously, it's the county. We want to answer any
questions. We want to be part of the county too. It's just
the concern is that less than three years.
I would have one suggestion if I was a member of the public, not as a planning board member. We discussed this as an emergency type action. You sent a sole letter that's not even certified, registered, or something.
Well, they go UPS, and we have track. I can assure you that the letter was sent and delivered.
If you're going to tell me it's an emergency and it comes down to secret's close and it's a final determination, because there's a host of issues associated with this application, you have to be able to pass that test for the public to show them that it's as much of an emergency on your side for your application that you put forward as it is for those people who are reviewing the assessments.
Yeah, so this is obviously a project that's being done for the public good and safety, so...
We understand that very well.
The letter that went to the supervisor meets the requirements of secret. There's no special delivery required, there's no Pony Express required, so I have no issue with the fact that the letter went, and I have no issue with the law under secret, which is also very clear. If there's a non-response, it's viewed as a vote yes, and we deal with this all the time, so... There's no issue on that. We only have one issue in front of us, and that is what
the extent of your involvement as it relates to approval of the site plan.
Exactly.
And now, just to be specific, it was referred to you because it's a public slash municipal facility listed as a site plan review use.
I got it, but I don't have it. So, put our lawyer on it. I mean, you guys can get together, somebody give us an opinion on it, then we'll see where this, if we have involvement, great. If the law says we don't, then we won't be seeing you again.
All right, and if you do, then we'll come back.
And we thank you.
Don't worry, we'll let you know if you have to come back.
I would just do some public outreach.
Yeah.
So if you don't have to come back to us, because there's going to be some happy residents.
Well, thank you for your time.
Thanks.
The county, but to advise the county,
maybe you can try a casino up there.
Joe, you want to help me with these?
Sure.
These are revisions. What happened is one of the town board members became involved with trying to clean up our zoning ordinance, and we started out specifically with a concern over fireworks sales and whether or not we'd be dealing with temporary outdoor fireworks sales. Should have had Amanda while she's here. The county had approved some sales of fireworks on a limited basis from sometime in June until the 4th of July. I think that triggered the concern as to whether or not we were going to see outside vendors in the New Hartford Shopping Center selling fireworks. That's in the village, though, so it's out of our jurisdiction. So at that point, we sat down with Joe, and Joe said, as long as we're going to become involved with cleaning up our zoning ordinance, he had a number of other suggestions that have been presented to the board. You see, the last one with where we're including in all of the various sections, the sale of any type of fireworks is prohibited because we don't want to get involved with farmers market, outdoor sales, roadside stands, temporary vendors doing these fireworks sales. He also came up with an idea because we got looking at parking, and we talked about increasing the size of a legal parking space because that's become an issue. Specifically, and I shop there, Price Chopper on Commercial Drive, when they put in the Roadhouse in Core, it's become very, very, very difficult to find parking. And there was a concern over the number of parking spaces. Well, by increasing the size of the parking space, we're now going to be able to control the ability of some of these places to go forward, especially when they're classified as a shopping center, which Joe has been helpful in. Because if they qualify as a shopping center, it doesn't regulate if it's a restaurant, if it's a drive-thru, it, no matter what the use is, it's governed by a shopping center, not the specific use. So that one just relates to, how much did we increase the size?
1 foot.
Yeah,
1 foot. The next one, and I'm going backwards, was just relating to one of the schedules. The last two on the animal husbandry and raising of livestock, the chapter as it stands now says a minimum lot size of 3 acres shall be required. And Joe correctly inserted in the property shall be located in an ag or an RA zone for the animal husbandry. Joe, did you have anything you wanted to add? And these, I'm sorry, I talked too much.
No, the only other one was the modification of the number of houses on a lot. Currently, in certain zones, we allow two structures on a lot. That hasn't changed, but it spells out the fact that each home should have the required frontage for that home on that lot. So the lot should be twice as big as required for a single lot.
And this is in an agricultural district, right? Where agriculture is the principal use.
Correct.
Yeah.
No lot in any AR area should be used for more than one dwelling, except that how, actually, it's written a little odd. Those aren't included in the legislation. It's specifically limiting those zones to the one principal dwelling. All other zones can have the more than one.
So that's basically it.
What was that again?
I'm lost there, John.
Yeah. If you read one principal dwelling structure per lot, no lot in any A, RA, or LDR district shall be used for more than one dwelling structure, except that housing for a farm workforce may be permitted where agricultural is a principal use of the property and the required minimum frontage shall be provided for each dwelling. Well, by them saying no lot in any A, RA, or LA, LDR district, it means the other zones can be allowed to have the multiple dwellings.
Is that what you want?
That's the way it was written from the beginning. I just added that they have the minimum frontage.
Well, why should non-agriculture be able to do that then?
That's the way it was written. I just wanted to clarify that the frontage requirement had to be met.
But there's a requirement that agriculture be the principal use of, right?
Yeah, but
no.
Somebody in another zone.
Oh, you're saying if you're in, what are the other zones?
Any other district, they don't have to.
MDR zone.
Meet that requirement.
Yeah, that business zone.
Yeah, I don't like that.
That's the way it was always written.
I think we should revise that one.
I think you gotta clean it up.
That one needs to be revised.
Can you just remove the second sentence? Per lot, except, like, no lot, blah, blah, blah. One principal dwelling structure per lot, except that housing for a farm workforce, because you wanted to make an exception, right?
The confusing part of this ordinance is that every other zone allows more than one dwelling, except for these, when that condition is met.
Right, but you want to clear it up so that only when that condition is met is that allowed.
No, but he's saying all the other, the unnamed ones, all allow multiple.
I think it's as clear as the last thing we were just looking at. So why don't you redo this one and bring it back?
Thank you.
Let's get this over with.
What do you define as animal husbandry then?
I really define it in our order.
Is that chickens?
It's raising chickens.
As chickens?
Yeah.
They can have chickens in New York City. You can't have them in New Hartford?
No, only in agricultural, only on lot sizes of 3 acres or greater.
What about some that do already?
Let me know about it.
I'll know.
But is this,
my friends.
Is this new?
You saying Tony Tallarico's got
what are you clearing up?
The only thing I added to this is the A and RA zoning, because it was always meant to be an agricultural.
Yeah, the only addition to 118-69A, it reads, as we stand here, a minimum lot size of 3 acres shall be required. Joe has added the language, and the property shall be located in an A or RA zone. So obviously, if it's in a residential and you got over 3 acres, you can't raise livestock.
I disagree with that. I think a lot of, I think there has to be some stipulations, but somebody with 3 acres ought to be able to have a couple of chickens in today's society of wanting
organic
or whatever.
Why did this issue come up because of a particular problem?
No, we're just trying to clean up.
What happens is if you're ambiguous in your code, it makes it hard to enforce. So it was easier to specify the A and RA zones because that's where most of our large plots of land exist.
So as you were reviewing this, the code in your copious free time, I'm just curious because I have a couple questions, but...
You know, for writing.
Right.
Yeah, I don't like this, Joe.
I think a 3-acre lot or larger lot...
I like it deferred to what's cleared up a little better.
This was a lengthy process. It was a citizens committee. In fact, Ralph Humphries was on the citizens committee that dealt with the ordinance, the republic hearings, and then it got passed.
Well, what's our highest zone, R1A? I mean, I happen to have over 3 acres, but I also have some neighbors back. I tell you, if I had chickens out there running around at 6 o'clock in the morning, you're going to hear gunfire. I mean, it's more than reasonable, and I think it's expected.
Got to have quiet chickens, huh?
Oh, it's not a place for them.
Chickens get loose?
I'm not saying a word. I agree with this.
So it's just chickens. That's the only thing it's doing.
No. You can't have horses.
What about somebody who's got a cow or a goat? Or a goat or whatever.
Goats, pigs. I mean, it's not just chickens.
What's the difference between that and a dog? Would you like a rooster or a chicken getting out and attacking your dog on a leash?
Listen, I grew up on a farm. I know all about those things.
So did I, yeah. And I, like I said, I...
And they do crawl.
Well, let's put this to a vote. Most who think we ought to have horses running around my house will.
I do have a question. What's the definition of fireworks?
Well, the fireworks is a sticky matter because I brought this up after research. After writing the law and then researching further, the town really cannot regulate more strictly than the state ordinance. So those fireworks laws will be useless.
So we're not going to go with them?
No.
So if the county says I can, I can still sell fireworks on this.
Okay,
so two are off.
Which ones are off?
The fireworks one and the one that...
Chickens?
No, the one that nobody understood what was happening. More than one...
The lot.
I
like the parking one.
Yeah, the parking one I'd like, but I have a question. So where did these numbers come from? Is this more of a standardized numbering?
No, but I can...
Cars are bigger?
We used to have 10 by 18 as our standard parking space. And the councilman came up to me and he said, how can we regulate parking so that we don't have the same problem we have over in the Texas Roadhouse block? I said, well, one way of doing it is to increase the size of the minimum parking space. And I used Bill's Shopping Center as an example. He's got nice large parking spaces over there, which take up more room. If you take 23 spaces and increase it by a foot, you're reducing the quantity available.
And I'm not against this, but as an example, tonight we heard about the issue with the development and perhaps maybe not enough parking spaces. So would this be applicable to them? So now they just reduced their parking spots?
No. What this will do is, let's say somebody comes before us and wants to further develop a parking lot. Mm-hmm.
So it's for commercial enterprises and not residential.
No, this would be all.
Be all, but in future projects, not existing.
All future projects.
Right, but from my background, a 10-foot width is much more comfortable design. I mean, you have minimum widths for like bathroom stalls and architecture. Right. A 10-foot width is way more comfortable. Cars have the SUV. I mean, the 9x18 was done in the 70s when everyone had a compact car. So going back, that's how it reduced, and obviously to fit more parking in. But 10-foot width is definitely a more comfortable standard.
It is
a standard.
We're basically looking at making a move to accept something that we all agreed to based upon what we believe will keep us at a higher quality or higher standard than what we saw associated with previous.
Yes.
I don't have a problem with that one. I'm in the primer on that 3-acre stuff. I just bothers me.
Can we make the...
Yeah.
What do we got?
There's also the...
Take them individually, or is...
There's a very simple one, adding a permitted use in the park recreation zone for accessory structures. That was definitely a glitch in Schedule A.
That's 118.3.3. Okay.
Let's just go over them one at a time.
Okay, the first one was 118-22F, and that's the one we're concerned about, that language, correct?
Correct.
Yeah. The second one was the animal husbandry, adding the language, and the property shall be located in an A or RA zone. Is there a motion to recommend?
I recommend we disapprove it.
I made a motion.
Well, Anna said, is there a second to disapprove?
I'll second it.
All those in favor of that motion?
Aye.
Being disapproved.
Being disapproved.
Aye.
I disapprove.
That's four.
Well, who's that?
Were we clear on that motion?
Then you gotta start over, because I didn't get it.
He made the motion to advise the town board that the planning board disapproves this amendment.
Which one is the animal husbandry?
118-69A, which is animal raising of livestock. The vote was four.
To three.
Is everybody else voting?
Well, we didn't, are those against the motion?
I'm against it.
Okay.
Sorry, I took that for granted.
It was four to three to recommend to the town board to disapprove.
Which, of course, the town board...
I don't want to vote for something, I've said at many town board meetings, and this isn't offensive, I'm being sincere, I've said at many town board meetings where our town supervisor has been very clear that the zone, that the code, we went before the public, and the public had plenty of time to look at it, and all the employees had plenty of time to look at it, and it was great. And that he didn't want to see any changes to it because there was nothing of significance. And at least for me, I don't know enough about this. Is this a standard? Is this not a standard? Was this simply a mistake that was made? It's usually 6 acres, and we put three, and it was a mistake, like one of the other one we just took a look at. So for me, I'm not going to vote to make a change unless I knew more about it, and I apologize for not knowing more about it before I got here tonight.
You have every right to make that motion.
So I don't know if it's right or wrong. I don't want a chicken attacking the dog, okay? But I also believe that I don't know enough about the issue. I'm not educated enough to say, let's make three. I mean, was it a simple mistake that it should have been 6 acres instead of three?
The acreage wasn't changed. It was the fact...
It was just identifying the zone.
It's the zone in which it was.
Where these kinds of animals...
Is that normal? I don't know.
Well, farming...
Well, we voted on this, so...
The vote is done.
The next one is just to put the P in the column for the permitted uses in Schedule A for accessory use, customary structure, or use.
I vote to approve. Recommend it.
Second.
Second.
Third.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed?
So next is 118-82 with increasing the size of the parking spaces.
Move to approve.
Move to approve. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed?
The last one is the fireworks that Joe said about.
It's up. We're adjourned.
Okay, wait a minute, one thing. The animal husbandry, now who made the motion?
Reimer.
To disapprove. Recommend disapprove.
By Reimer, seconded by Knight.
Thank you.
Who voted against it?
The four on the...
Those people.
The four on the...
Those people.
The chicken lovers.
I'm going to have a chicken in your backyard.
Chicken and dog.
As
a matter of fact, you're probably right.
No, I'm serious.
Three, seven, four.
I'd rather have a barking dog.
And I think...
I don't think you need 3 acres in our district to have, or...
You know what?
I walk around Kiwanis all the time, and it doesn't fit, and they're attacked, my ankles aren't attacked.
But it does end if people are looking...
I wonder if...
Yeah.